Good day, all. Welcome to ICSS Sunday morning program at the Niebuhr Proctor Marxist Library. My name is Raj Sahai. The Institute for Critical Study of Society, acronym ICSS, was formed at the Niebuhr Proctor Marxist Library in 2004, so it's 19 years have passed, to preserve Marx's heritage and to support struggles for social justice and struggle for socialism leading to communism. The opinions expressed in our forum are only that of its authors, but we are all united in our respect for the work of Karl Marx, who in his 11th thesis on Feuerbach said, quote, "The philosophers have interpreted the word in different ways. The point, however, is to change it," end of quote. Our speaker today is researcher, historian, and author, Professor Grover Furr of Montclair State University in New Jersey. His talk today is titled, "Stalin Exonerated, Fact-Checking the Death of Solomon Mikhoels." On the night of January 12, 1948, a prominent actor and director of Yiddish language, Soviet theater, and winner of Stalin Prize of 1946, Solomon Mikhailovich Mikhoels, together with a friend Vladimir Golubov, were killed in a hit-and-run accident on a dark street in Minsk, which then was a Byelorussian Soviet Socialist Republic. Mikhoels were buried with honors and praised in the Soviet press. Nevertheless, rumors that he had been murdered by the Soviet state began to circulate almost immediately. During the 1960s, these rumors multiplied, occasionally being repeated in official sources. Beginning in 1991, documents began to appear claiming that Joseph Stalin had ordered Mikhoels' assassination. But why? Professor Furr began his investigation of this case, Mikhoels' case, in 2004. His research of past over three decades have produced a number of books on Soviet history of the Stalin period, 1924 to 1953. His book titled Khrushchev Lied was published in 2011, and that's when I met him, which has been translated into many languages. His newest book, Stalin Exonerated, was published last month. We hope to find out from him in his talk today, what is the significance of the charge of Mikhoels' assassination in Stalin? It seems to me very strange that after the World War II, this great leader would order murder of a theater director. Stalin died in 1953 and socialism itself was abolished in Russia in 1992. Does anyone kick a dead dog? I don't think so. But he will unravel the mystery. Please join me in welcoming Professor Grover Furr.
Thank you very much. Just one more time, how's this sound?
Sounds okay. Good.
Okay, that's great. Hello to all of you. Thank you for logging on to listen to my talk. I hope we can have an interesting and productive Q&A session after I have finished speaking. Before I get to my main topic for today, I would like to say something about a more general and important issue. That issue is the complete reversal of our understanding of the high politics of Soviet history during the Stalin period that I and my colleague, Vladimir L. Babarov, have been working on for the past 20 years. What we have been discovering step by step and question by question is that the understanding of Stalin's activity that has dominated our understanding of Soviet history since the time of Nikita Khrushchev is completely false. For almost 70 years, Stalin has been portrayed as a dictator and a criminal who ordered hundreds of murders of hundreds of thousands of innocent people. This erroneous, even demonized view of Stalin was enhanced, magnified under Mikhail Gorbachev between 1986 and 1981. It has dominated the field of Soviet history ever since Khrushchev. That domination continues to this day. Khrushchev's secret speech, in which, as you will recall, Khrushchev dishonestly accused Stalin of many serious crimes, as well as of ruling as a dictator, this speech gave new life to a worldwide Trotskyist movement that by 1956 was in steep decline. Gorbachev's equally fraudulent campaign against Stalin and the Soviet leadership of Stalin's time enhanced Trotsky's reputation even more. Today, the Trotskyite movement around the world is numerous and influential. Yet, like the mainstream, frankly anti-communist field of Soviet history, the Trotskyite movement is based on lies. Trotsky's own lies, first, and then the lies of the phony historians of the Khrushchev and Gorbachev eras, and the lies of anti-communist historians, academic and semi-popular. The understanding of persons on the left, of persons who regard themselves as socialists and communists, has also been poisoned by the lies about Stalin. We must understand with crystal clarity, Trotsky and Khrushchev knew that they were lying about Stalin. So did Khrushchev's phony historians. As for Gorbachev, he believed the lies of the Khrushchev era. His right-hand man, Alexander Yakovlev, a fervent anti-communist since Khrushchev's day, a longtime associate of Gorbachev's and member of Gorbachev's Politburo, stated that his goal was to destroy the communist movement by any means necessary. Marxist theory, ever since Khrushchev's day, has based itself on the demonized view of Stalin peddled by Trotsky, Khrushchev, Gorbachev, the phony historians they sponsored, and by mainstream anti-communist Soviet scholars, all of whom embrace this false version of Stalin. The lies about the Stalin period have poisoned Marxist theory to the root. The lies about Stalin and about Soviet history of the Stalin period are fundamental to all Marxist theory since the mid-1950s. The discovery that it was based upon accepting lies about Stalin and the Stalin period has fatally undermined all Marxist and communist theory in the past 70 years. All of this theory must be done over again in the light of the exposure of the lies of the past and the discovery still ongoing of what really happened during the Stalin period. The Mikhoels case should be of great interest to all of us because our discovery that it is a deliberate falsification by prominent professional historians shows an unmistakable detail how corrupt the field of Soviet history is and has been since Trotsky's day. Our whole understanding of the history of the world communist movement of the 20th century has to be completely revised in the light of the historical facts as we are now uncovering them. Okay, the title of our new book, ours meaning Vladimir Bobrov's and mine, is Stalin Exonerated, Fact-Checking the Death of Solomon Mikhoels. I'm just gonna hold up a copy of it here so you can see that it really exists. And there we are, that's the cover. In it, we examined our discovery of a historical falsification. That falsification is the charge, now universally accepted as true, that Joseph Stalin ordered the murder of Jewish theater director Solomon Mikhoels and a companion, Vladimir Golubov, on the evening of January 12, 1948 in Minsk, capital of the Byelorussian Soviet Socialist Republic. We exposed the forgery of a number of documents and the insertion of some of them into formerly classified Soviet archives. The exposure of this falsification has broad implications. The purported murder of Solomon Mikhoels and a companion at Stalin's order is routinely cited as established fact. Someone earlier referenced the Wikipedia page on Mikhoels, and you can read about it there. In reality, it is a fraud based on crude forgeries. There has never been an objective, systematic study of this material. In this book, we present just such a study. Solomon Mikhoels was a Soviet actor and director in the Yiddish theater. He was one of the most honored Soviet artists of the time. He was People's Artist of the Russian Republic in 1935, People's Artist of the Soviet Union, recipient of the Order of Lenin in 1939, member of the Stalin Prize Committee, and himself a recipient of that prize, first class, in 1946. He was also the chairman of the Jewish Anti-Fascist Committee, a group formed in 1941 to help rally Jews in the West around the defense of the Soviet Union, where Hitler was murdering millions of Jews. During the night of January 12th to 13th, 1948, the bodies of Mikhoels and a colleague, Vladimir Golubov, were found lying on a street in Minsk. Friends of these two men told the investigators that they had been going on foot to a dinner or reception not far away. A police investigation concluded that they were victims of a hit and run. Mikhoel's body was buried with honor. Laudatory obituary articles appeared in the Soviet press. But shortly after their deaths, rumors began to circulate that Mikhoels and Golubov had been murdered by the Soviet government. The primary document supporting this rumor, supposedly from a Soviet archive, became known only in 1992. This is an alleged letter to Georgi Malenkov, at that time the head of state, that is, chairman of the Council of Ministers of the Soviet Union, by Lavrenty Beria, head of both the Ministry of State Security, the MGB, and the Ministry of Internal Affairs, the MVD. Additional documents purporting to bear on the murder were published later. All of the indisputably genuine documents concerning Mikhoels and Golubov's deaths were composed before the end of the Soviet Union. They all state that Mikhoels, I will refer only to him from now on, died as a result of a hit-and-run accident involving some kind of motor vehicle. None of these documents were published until after the end of the Soviet Union. So before 1991, there were only rumors. We study these rumors in chapter one. Some are in memoirs, like those of Stalin's daughter, Svetlana Aleluyeva, whose different versions of her memoirs contradict one another on this question. Others are in the writings of Soviet dissidents, like Roy Medvedev's book, Let History Judge. Still others are in Nikita Khrushchev's memoirs, first published in the early 1970s and published again in Russian in the last months of the Soviet Union in 1991. Different editions of Khrushchev's memoirs contradict each other too. Clearly they have been manipulated since Khrushchev's death and are of no historical value. Some of the pre-1992 accounts blame Lavrenty Beria, a favorite target of vilification by Khrushchev and his men, and later by Gorbachev and his men. Some of these accounts do not mention Stalin at all. In May 1992, the first version of what I call the Beria letter was published in a popular magazine, Argumenti e Facti, AIF. In 1994, writer and journalist Arkady Vaksberg claimed that he had discovered this Beria letter and published an English translation of it in his book, Stalin Against the Jews. However, Vaksberg claimed that he discovered the document in a different archive than one identified in Argumenti e Facti. Oddly, in the 1995 Russian edition of this book, Vaksberg does not claim that he was the person who had discovered the Beria letter. So we do not know who created this, the original version of the Beria letter, or where it came from. There are a number of striking features of this Beria letter. First, Beria is more or less the hero. He is investigating Mikhoel's murder and exposing the role of Stalin and the MGB in it. This is noteworthy since right up until the end of the Soviet Union in December 1991, Beria was slandered, abused, and lied about even more than Stalin was and still is. Second, the Beria letter fails to cite the date that Mikhoels was killed. It also gets the month wrong. It states that Mikhoels was killed in February, whereas he was really killed in January. Thirdly, it does not identify the street in Minsk where the bodies were found. What are the chances that a subordinate to Beria, a government minister, and his boss would present his chief with such a flawed document? Obviously, the forger did not know the month and date of Mikhoel's death or the name of the street. Yet these details are in the official report dated January 14th, the day after the bodies were found, and again in an official follow-up report of February 1948. It follows that the forger did not have access to the official reports. Therefore, the Beria letter did not come from Beria or Beria's office, and therefore it is a fake, a fabrication, a forgery. But there's a lot more to this forgery. In 1993, writer Alexander Borchagovsky published a version of the Beria letter that contained some of the text of the AIF Voxburg version, but also added a great deal more text. The next year, Borchagovsky republished his version in a book. He mentions the AIF Voxburg text, but does not explain the differences between that text and his. In 1996, Israeli historian Shimon Redlich and Gennady Kosturchenko, a Russian historian who specializes in Jewish history, published a version of the Beria letter that is different from Borchagovsky's text, although they falsely claim that they had taken their text from Borchagovsky. In the document collection Lavrenti Beria 1953, published in 1999 by the Anti-Communist Memorial Society, the text of the Beria letter has changed again. This edition claims that the text was taken from an archive and gives archival identification numbers. In Gennady Kosturchenko's 2005 book, State Anti-Semitism in the USSR, the text is different yet again. In the English language volume, War, Holocaust, and Stalinism, published in 2016, the editors, Redlich again, Anderson, and Altman, claim that they have published the same text that Redlich and Kosturchenko published in 1996, only translated into English. But it is not the same text. In our book, we carefully compare the various texts of the Beria letter. We disclose how it was changed, additions and deletions made, and that it was finally inserted into an important archive so it would look genuine. When you read the chapter on the Beria letter, you will see it yourself. I do not blame you if you have trouble believing it. How could respected experts in Soviet history fabricate such a document and then insert it into an archive? How could the entire field of Soviet history, hundreds of scholars worldwide, fail to discover this fraud? Yet that is the case. The field of Soviet history of the Stalin period is thoroughly corrupt. I have demonstrated the truth of this statement in most of my books. For example, in my book about the second volume of Stephen Kotkin's biography of Stalin, Kotkin's book is titled Stalin Waiting for Hitler, 1929 to 1941. My analysis is titled Stalin Waiting for the Truth. In it, I show that Kotkin deliberately lies and falsifies his sources dozens of times. Kotkin fails to find a single bit of evidence for even one of the crimes of which he accuses Stalin. And Kotkin's book is just one example, although he's arguably the most famous scholar of the Stalin period in the world. Six more documents are cited in support of the story that Stalin ordered Mikhail's murder. All of these documents come from a novel, a work of fiction, by Russian writer Viktor Levashov. Levashov published this novel, titled The Murder of Mikhoels, in 1998. It was republished in 2002. Levashov said that the republication was made possible through financial help from the Israeli government. Interesting, right? Levashov's novel begins with an imaginary interrogation of Yosif Jugashvili, that is, Stalin. Levashov inserts other fictional documents, too. In among them, he includes the five documents cited by all authorities as documentary evidence that Stalin ordered Mikhoels to be murdered. Incidentally, Levashov is very forthcoming about the origin of these documents. He states that his publisher had bought them for $2,000 from an anonymous man who said that he was a former KGB agent. Levashov clearly believes that the documents are genuine, but admits that he can't prove this. Levashov even calls Kosturchenko a liar because Kosturchenko said in print that these documents were taken from a former Soviet archive. Levashov insisted that they were only in his novel Nowhere Else. My co-author, Vladimir Bobrov, and I carefully examine all of these documents. We note the contradictions among them. In chapter 5, we study the official documents that prove that Mikhoels was not murdered by Stalin. These are the Kruglov and Badunov reports, official reports of January and February 1948, plus the Solomyantsev-Yakovlev report of 1988, the Gorbachev period. Solomyantsev and Yakovlev were high-ranking party members loyal to Gorbachev. It was they, along with some other senior party officials, who were in charge of producing phony evidence that Stalin had had many people murdered. Solomyantsev and Yakovlev stated that they need to search everything in the archives in order to support the rehabilitation of the Jewish Anti-Fascist Committee, of which Mikhoels had been chairman at the time of his death. In their report, they note, but only in passing, that Mikhoels had been killed in an auto accident. Now, these men hated Stalin. They would never have neglected to mention that Stalin had murdered Mikhoels if they had had any evidence of it. All the evidentiary documents, the Beria letter, the documents published in Levashov's novel, were supposedly residing in some archive, specifically the archive of the Politburo and the MGB archive in 1988. Yet Solomyantsev and Yakovlev and their researchers knew nothing about them. Obviously, then, these documents were not in any archive. This confirms our own analysis. The documents that constitute the so-called evidence that Stalin ordered the MGB to murder Mikhoels are fabrications. We devote a chapter to a translation and detailed study of Gennady Kostyuchenko's account of Mikhoels' murder from the latest edition, 2015, of his book, Stalin's Secret Policy, Power and Anti-Semitism. That's the title of Kostyuchenko's book. This is the authoritative account. We translate Kostyuchenko's account into English. This is the only translation available of Kostyuchenko's version of Mikhoels' supposed murder. Then we analyze it paragraph by paragraph. We demonstrate how dishonest it is. Kostyuchenko's story falls apart at every turn. We also reproduce the original Russian text so that anyone who can read the Russian language can see that we have accurately recorded, without distortion, what Kostyuchenko wrote. In another chapter, we compare what two Russian writers, Yuri Mukhin and Jaurès Medvedev, have written about the allegation that Stalin ordered Mikhoels murdered. Mukhin was the first person in Russia to publicly reject this story. His 2003 book, The Murder of Stalin and Beria, contains many shrewd remarks about lies concerning Stalin and Beria that were promoted during the Khrushchev and Gorbachev years. We deal carefully with Mukhin's arguments, even though we are well aware that in the politically poisoned world of Soviet history, it is considered taboo to take seriously anything that Mukhin writes. Jaurès Medvedev, brother of the more famous Soviet dissident, Roy Medvedev, was a scientist and also a Soviet-era dissident. Jaurès Medvedev explicitly rejects the Beria letter as a fake. Medvedev also rejects the very idea that Stalin was anti-Semitic. He wrote, "Stalin's only anti-Semitism was anti-Zionism." He wrote this in the face of Kostyuchenko's insisting the opposite and publishing a collection of documents titled State Anti-Semitism in the Soviet Union, where he, Kostyuchenko, enshrines all the forged documents as official documents and genuine evidence. But Medvedev was very gentle with his fellow anti-communist Kostyuchenko. Medvedev never states outright that the Beria letter is a fake. He just gives all his reasons for rejecting it. Medvedev's 2003 book, Stalin and the Jewish Problem, has never been translated. Consequently, very few people know that this prominent anti-communist dissident rejected the story that Stalin had Mikhoels murdered. Okay, what is the significance of our research? First, we have proven beyond any doubt that Stalin did not have Mikhoels murdered. Second, we have proven that some very prominent anti-communist historians have falsified documents, passing them off as genuine and inserting them into an archive. This is important because the fact that the field of Soviet history is thoroughly corrupt is not generally known. It is good to have this additional evidence to prove it. It is also important because it demonstrates the determination among anti-communists to equate the Soviet Union with Nazi Germany, communism with fascism, and Stalin with Hitler. To equate Stalin with Hitler, as, for example, Timothy Snyder of Yale University does in his book, Bloodlands, Europe Between Hitler and Stalin, it is important to demonstrate that, like Hitler, Stalin hated Jews. The umbrella term to link communism with fascism is, quote, totalitarian. There is a serious campaign by capitalists worldwide to outlaw the advocacy of communism, communist symbols, communist parties, and individuals by falsely equating communism with fascism, and especially by equating Stalin with Hitler. Our discovery that the Beria letter is a falsification is yet another example of what I have called the anti-Stalin paradigm. This is the unwritten rule in the field of Soviet history, according to which it is unacceptable, taboo, to doubt, let alone to disprove, any crime or misdeed that Stalin has been accused of. The lie that Stalin had Mikhoels murdered and all the documents we study in this book have been circulating for 25 to 30 years. This lie should have been exposed years ago by historians in the field, but none of the legitimated historians have done so. Jaurès Medvedev's rejection of the story was published 20 years ago, but none of those who read his book have spread the word that Medvedev rejected the bona fides of the main document, the Beria letter. In the academic field of American history, on the other hand, perpetrators of similar frauds have lost their positions. One well-known example, there are several others, is that of Michael Belsiles. His name is spelled Belsiles, but I understand he pronounces it in the French, Belsile. But I'm going to say Belsiles. Here is an excerpt from the account of the Belsiles case from Wikipedia. Arming America, The Origins of a National Gun Culture is a discredited 2000 book by historian Michael A. Belsiles about American gun culture, an expansion of a 1996 article he published in the Journal of American History. Belsiles, then a professor at Emory University, used fabricated research to argue that during the early period of US history, guns were uncommon during peacetime, and that a culture of gun ownership did not arise until the mid-19th century. Although the book was awarded the prestigious Bancroft Prize in 2001, it later became the first work for which the prize was rescinded, following a decision of Columbia University's Board of Trustees that Belsiles had, quote, violated basic norms of scholarship and the high standards expected of Bancroft Prize winners. Belsiles disputed these findings, claiming to have followed all scholarly standards and to have corrected all errors of fact known to him. Nevertheless, with his reputation in tatters, Belsiles issued a statement on October 25, 2002, announcing the resignation of his professorship at Emory University by year's end. In 2010, he published his first book since the scandal while working as an adjunct professor at Central Connecticut State University. In 2012, Belsiles was working at a bartender while continuing to write history. The Belsiles case shows that in the academic field of American history, there is some kind, at least, of policing, of checking up on the validity, the honesty of a scholar's research. But in the field of Soviet history, the opposite is true. Baseless, fraudulent accusations against Stalin are rewarded. Careers like those of Timothy Snyder of Yale and Stephen Kotkin of Princeton are built upon such lies. And of course, the academic careers of all Trotskyist historians are built upon lies too. I would like to say something specifically about historiography by Trotskyist researchers and academics. Trotskyist historians, I will just use the word Trotskyist from now on, are both similar to anti-communist bourgeois historians and in a way worse than them. They are similar because they repeat anti-communist and particularly anti-Stalin allegations of crimes, atrocities, and so on, without evidence. But Trotskyists are different because they are compelled to echo whatever Trotsky himself wrote back in the 1920s and especially in the 1930s, after he was exiled from the Soviet Union. So, in addition to repeating uncritically the allegations of the anti-communist bourgeois historians, allegations which we can now disprove by use of evidence, Trotskyists must also defend Trotsky by repeating Trotsky's actions, and particularly by repeating Trotsky's allegations of crimes and so forth against Stalin. Now, I have published four books in which I examine all of Trotsky's major charges against Stalin. In these studies, these books, I take up the allegations one at a time, and I disprove them by reference to primary source evidence. Much of the time, this primary source evidence consists of documents from formerly secret Soviet archives. Since the end of the USSR in 1991, and especially since about the year 2000, an enormous number of such documents have been published in Russia, either in articles, in books, or on the internet. In 2021, Jean-Jacques Marie published two direct attacks on me and my research in supposedly left-wing journals. Who is Jean-Jacques Marie? A few years ago, a friend of mine who was also one of the leading Trotskyists in the United States told me that Jean-Jacques Marie is the foremost Trotskyist historian in the world today. I composed detailed researched responses in which I refute each and every allegation in both of Marie's articles. The journals in which Marie published his attacks on me and my research refused to publish my responses, even though I had been attacked by name in Marie's articles. So I published them on my own webpage. They were also picked up and published in some online blogs and journals. You can find Marie's attacks on me and my responses on my homepage under the dates December 29th, 2021 and January 9th, 2022. So what's my point here? It is that even the most famous Trotskyist historian in the world could not refute my research. In fact, it's worse than that. Marie appears to have forgotten how to do historical research. That's assuming he ever knew how. So that was a lesson for me. I learned that Trotskyist so-called experts could simply not deal with the truth as demonstrated by the best primary source evidence. I also deal with Trotskyist lies, outright lies, deliberate falsification of fact on the website Marxist.org, which is basically still a Trotskyist site. The article in which I do that is on my homepage under the date January 31st, 2023, and is entitled, quote, Marxist Behaving Badly, Anti-Stalinism on the Left. Some of you may recall that I gave an earlier version of this article as a talk at the ICSS on March 8th, 2020. Since about 2002, I have been studying the allegations of crimes, murders, atrocities, and so on that have been leveled against Stalin. There are four sources of these allegations against Stalin. First, Trotsky and those who supported him, Second, Khrushchev and the phony historians sponsored by Khrushchev, especially after the 22nd Party Congress of October 1961. Third, Gorbachev and the phony historians Gorbachev sponsored from 1986 on. Gorbachev's anti-Stalin and in fact anti-communist campaign went way beyond Khrushchev's, and Khrushchev's was important, and the influence of his attacks on Stalin was immense, both within the Soviet Union and especially among anti-communist historians outside of the Soviet Union. The fourth source of allegations against Stalin is the work of post-Soviet Western, that is non-Russian historians, many of them in Eastern Europe. I am often called a Stalinist. I am also called a pseudo-historian. This is what the Trotskyist site, WSWS.org, that's worldsocialistwebsite.org, now calls me, pseudo-historian. What the hell is a pseudo-historian? Or I am just called, quote, not a historian at all. Or it is sometimes said that my work can be disregarded because mainstream anti-communist professional historians do not engage my work, do not quote it, do not even refer to it in their own writings. So let me say something about all of that. First, this is a logical fallacy, the fallacy of ad hominem argument. A friend of mine who has a law degree told me that a courtroom tactic of defense attorneys is as follows. When you have the evidence, use it. When you do not have the evidence, attack the persons. That's what's happening to me. It should be obvious that the only thing that counts in historical research is evidence and the interpretation of evidence. You cannot discover the truth by referring to a historian's reputation, whether good or bad. It is irrelevant. Nevertheless, I have received many emails from interested readers of my work who ask me to respond to the charge, quote, charge, that, quote, Furr is not a historian, or, quote, reputable historians do not refer to his work, or, quote, disregard his work as unworthy of attention, or, quote, Furr is a Stalinist, or, quote, Furr is no different than a denier of the Holocaust. I get that quite a bit. Clearly, such people do not know, or pretend not to know, that evidence and evidence alone is valid in the investigation of any historical fact claim. It is also clear that many people do not know what evidence is, that the opinions of other historians, no matter how famous they or their universities are, or the universities they're associated with are not evidence. I recently received an email from a person who asked me, quote, how does a historian determine that a document is a forgery? There is no single answer to this question. Anyone who has dealt with historical research knows this, but this person, and I suspect most people, do not know this. They do not know how to analyze documents and determine what evidence is. Although you'll get a good lesson in how to do that, more than one lesson, if you study the book that Vladimir and I have just finished and that I'm speaking about. Okay, you'll see how to study documents and how to show that when a document is a forgery. Okay. I am sometimes asked whether a given historian or even anti-communist or Trotskyist historians in general are dishonest or incompetent. In my experience, the answer is usually they are both. In a corrupt field like Soviet history of the Stalin period, where a historian can make virtually any allegation of crime against Stalin without fear that any other historian will disagree with it, let alone try to disprove it, dishonesty leads to incompetence. If no one ever corrects you when you make false statements about Stalin because they like the fact that you are attacking Stalin, then why should you be careful to support your conclusions with good evidence? So you get into the habit of making false statements about Stalin because you know your colleagues will not correct you. You will not get caught. And pretty soon you will have forgotten how to do decent research, assuming you ever knew how. This is the situation with mainstream Soviet history today, worldwide, with only a handful of exceptions. Somewhere or other here, I have my last page. One of the many falsehoods promoted by anti-communist bourgeois historians and by Trotskyists is that Stalin was anti-Semitic. In our book, Vladimir and I prove that Stalin did not have Mikhoel's murder. Moreover, there is no evidence that Stalin was anti-Semitic in any other event in Soviet history during his lifetime. In his book, Stalin and the Jewish Problem, Joris Medvedev wrote, quote, Stalin's anti-Semitism, about which one can read in almost all biographies, was not based on religion, ethnicity, or culture. It was political and expressed itself as anti-Zionism and not as hostility towards Jews, page 92. But this statement is entirely ignored by historians of the Soviet Union. No wonder. It pulls the rug out from under one of the central goals of mainstream anti-communist and Trotskyist historiography, to equate Stalin with Hitler, the Soviet Union with Nazi Germany, and communism with fascism. It dismantles the phony concept of totalitarianism, the sole purpose of which is to yoke communism together with fascism, rather than to recognize that fascism is simply another form of capitalism and is deadly opposed to communism and by communists. Therefore, the fact that Stalin has been proven innocent, exonerated, in this case, is one more powerful indictment of the entire field of Soviet studies. In fact, it is not just that Stalin did not order the killing of Mikhoels. I have researched alleged crimes of Stalin for more than 20 years now. I can tell you with confidence that there is no evidence that Stalin ever ordered the death of even a single person except for that of Leon Trotsky. And there the question is, why did Stalin wait so long to have Trotsky killed? If you wish, we can discuss this further informally during the Q&A session. Thank you for listening.
Thank you. Thank you very much. So we'll now go into some announcements, which I will make, and then come back with questions and discussion session that follows it.
Okay, so, I'm going to take a little break, Raj. Okay, I'll be back in 2 minutes. I have to use.
I will take more than 2 minutes to make my announcements.
Okay.
All right, fine. So what's coming up? So I'll tell you next 2 weeks what's happening in this forum. So August 20th is, the title is What's Happening in Turkey? Speaker is Mehmet Behram, who is a member of the planning committee of ICSS. And he's presently in Turkey, which is his home country. He actually lives here, but he spends a lot of time now that he's retired. He will be speaking. We'll be bringing an update on that. Turkey is a very key, strategically located country. And therefore, its relationship with Russia, United States, NATO, et cetera, is a key to what is going on in Ukraine as well. So that should be a very interesting session. August 27 is Mary Louise Patterson. She'll speak on her book, Letters from Langston, from the Harlem Renaissance to the Red Scare and beyond. And that should be a very interesting talk as well. So, with those two announcements, I also want to say, if you want to look up what's going on in our forum, best place to go is to the website icssmarks.org. There you can also sign up. If you haven't signed up yet, you can sign up and we'll start getting announcements of upcoming programs in your email. So I would encourage you to go there. Our programs are posted on YouTube, which hasn't kicked us out, which I think could happen because they are doing it to any significant opposition to the government line on foreign policy, at least, if not domestic policy. So that could happen. And for that reason, we have a copy of our programs, and we'll be talking to you about that when that change happens. So the format of, I want to remind you, this is a comradely forum. Everybody will get a chance to ask a question. Please raise your hand. And if you don't know how to do it, just go to the bottom of the screen, and there you will have a reactions button. Button in a sense, you know, there is an identified space there called reaction. And when you hit that, it gives you some choices. And one of them is raise hand. So you push that and your hand would be raised. I will try to go in sequence. Although if your name gets skipped over, don't worry, I'll come back to you. I'll make sure everybody is able to ask a question or make a comment. And about that, let me tell you what the rules are. First of all, is please do not interrupt either this speaker or the moderator, and follow moderator's direction if you are going if you're running too long and your time to speak when you get a chance, speak then. It's about 2 minutes. Okay. And then when you finish in 2 minutes, try to finish in 2 minutes. I will not just completely cut you off, but try to stick to 2 minutes. The author, the speaker does not have time limit. And then we'll go sequentially. So Grover is back. So with that, I would like to go to the first person whose raised hand I can see here. That is Bonnie Weiss. And after that is Yusuf, then Eugene. These are the three raised hands. Bonnie, please go ahead.
Okay, can you hear me?
Yes.
Oh, good, good. Okay, hi, Grover.
Oh, yeah.
The big lie about Stalin allegedly murdering Soviet Jews goes far beyond the case of Solomon Mikhoels.
Sure.
For example, and I know you know this, and I want you to elaborate on it. Paul Robeson Jr., in speaking to the American anti-communist press, claimed that his father had told him, and only him, that when Paul Robeson met in his hotel room with Itzhak Pfeffer, an anti-Zionist leader in the Jewish community, Pfeffer signaled to Robeson that the hotel room was bugged and that they should communicate via written notes and hand signals and so forth, and that Pfeffer told him all the secrets about Stalin's murder of Soviet Jews. So because the story came from Paul Robeson Jr., it was accepted as fact and was propagated worldwide as part of the anti-Stalin, anti-Soviet Cold War narrative. And it stands today as as if it were fact. So I'd like you to speak to that case. Thank you.
Okay. Well, Pfeffer, Itzhak Pfeffer was a member, like Mikhoels, of the Jewish Anti-Fascist Committee. And Mikhoels, of course, was killed by a hit-and-run accident, as I've outlined, in January 1948. Had he not been killed, though, he almost certainly would have been arrested with the leaders of the Jewish Anti-Fascist Committee, who were arrested starting in 1949, eventually were put on trial for espionage in 1952, and all but one of them were executed. Now, after Stalin's death, they were rehabilitated. That is to say, they were declared to have been innocent. This is a really interesting case. And the problem, and of course, I'm not saying anything about it, whether they were really guilty or whether they were really innocent. The accepted version is that they were in fact innocent, but it's a lot more interesting and complicated than that. But the main, our main roadblock to understanding that specific case is that there's a law in Russia today that documents shall be declassified after 75 years. Now, the 1930s were over 75 years ago. So was much of World War II, maybe all of it. 1952 is not 75 years ago. So we don't have all of the evidence in the case of the Jewish Anti-Fascist Committee. So I don't deal with the Jewish Anti-Fascist Committee in this particular book, but a couple of things about that particular incident, and then I'll mention one or two other things. First of all, I've looked into all of the information we have because I'm curious too. There's no evidence that Stalin had anything to do with it. Stalin was, by 1952, seldom attending meetings. He was in very bad health. Of course, he died in March 1953. He didn't even sign documents. There was a rubber stamp created by the Politburo, I'm sure with his permission, to stamp documents since he was the head of state. Because he was often just not in condition to sign any documents. So they did it, they had a rubber stamp created. So whether Stalin had anything to do with it is dubious. I've never seen any evidence that he did, but that doesn't mean that they weren't executed. Of course they were. We don't have full information. The judge, and this is gonna be a very interesting case when we do get some information. The judge in the case was a guy named Chepsov, who lived a long time. He lived up until the 1990s. And he claimed that he thought that they were all innocent, but that Malenkov had told him to convict them. Now, so he did. So now, if that actually happened, I have my doubts. If that actually happened, the Chepsov committed a criminal act. I mean, for him as a judge to convict somebody he thought was innocent is terrible. Yet that's what he said he did. Chepsov's assistant was also Ganim Grishayev. He's also lived until the 1990s. And Grishayev said, no, that's not right. Chepsov wanted to delay the trial and then delay the executions because he thought that there was more investigation to be done. That is to say, he thought that these people were guilty. So as you can see, it's a real mare's nest. We don't really know what the hell was going on with the Jewish Anti-Fascist Committee. I assume that that's what Pfeffer was talking to Paul Robeson Jr. or Paul Robeson about. And then Robeson supposedly told Paul Robeson Jr. these things. Could be. I did ask a colleague of mine who lives around whose office is around the corner from me, a very nice guy, wonderful guy, not in my department. He's in the Justice Studies department. And he is a political conservative and super Zionist. So I asked him a couple of years ago when I was working on this book, I said, listen, Harry, I described the situation of the Jewish Anti-Fascist Committee, and I said they were convicted of espionage. Is it anti-Semitic to convict Jews of espionage? And he said, no, of course not. He said, as long as they're being convicted of a crime, it's not anti-Semitic to convict them. I said, well, suppose it turns out that they were wrongly convicted. That is to say that they were really innocent. Is that anti-Semitic? And he said, no, if the evidence, you know, that was available to the court showed that they were guilty, then even if it turns out later on that they were innocent, it's not anti-Semitic. So it all depends upon the evidence that was presented to the court. It all depends upon the evidence. And that's what we don't have. Okay, that's what we don't have yet. I'm not saying we're gonna get it after the 75 years. So what's 75 years after 1952?
2027.
I'm not saying we're gonna get it then, because the Russian government doesn't always do that. They don't always release the documents after the 75 years. But I think there's some chance that they'll do it. And then we will see. But in any case, I know, for example, the Politburo sent a very high-ranking Bolshevik, a guy named Shkiryatov, to specifically speak to each of the defendants, who, of course, by that time were in prison, about the case. And they all told him, allegedly, I mean, this is what we are told, they all told him that they were guilty. So it's really, the case of the Jewish Anti-Fascist Committee is really a mare's nest. However, there are other alleged anti-Semitic issues in the post-war Stalin period. And I deal with some of them, like, for example, the famous doctor's plot case. I deal with that in my book, Blood Lies. And it's very clear that this was not a trumped up case. It's very clear that the doctors really did conspire to, in fact, they admitted it, to give bad medical treatment to Andrei Zhdanov, who was in the Politburo, very close to Stalin, and who died. They claimed that they did it by mistake and Khrushchev let them off. And maybe that's true. Maybe they did it by mistake. Maybe it was an error. But in any case, they agree that they had all gotten together and decided that Zhdanov's heart condition was not really very bad. He could get up and walk around. Zhdanov got up and walked around and collapsed and died. So, you know, I would say there's no evidence that Stalin was anti-Semitic. But like Medvedev said, it's perfectly clear that he was anti-Zionist. And that's really where we're at today. I hope that is a sufficient answer. It's really all I can tell you now.
Okay.
Thank you.
Sure.
Okay. So next is Yusuf. Please unmute yourself and say what you have to say. You have 2 minutes.
Okay. Thank you very much. Actually, you made a very convincing argument, and even though I didn't read the details in your book, I'm quite convinced. Thank you. You mentioned Yakovlev more than once, and it seems that he was Gorbachev made him the responsible for party education, and it seemed that he admitted conspiring before Gorbachev became general secretary to have a plan to dismantle socialism.
Yeah.
In the Soviet Union, and are you aware of that? Is it true? Could you elaborate? And actually, I think it's worth publicizing in the book.
Yeah, I guess so. I guess it is. Okay. You know, I haven't managed to do that yet, but it would be probably is. All right. So, yeah, you probably have all heard about this book that was published first in 1999 in France called The Black Book of Communism. And then it was published pretty quickly in English translation entitled with that title and ultimately translated into many other languages. This is back in the 1990s. This is when this book was composed. And I have something to say about the 1990s, but I'll save that for a second. So eventually this book gets translated and published in Russian, you know, in the early 2000s. And Yakovlev wrote a preface to that book, but just the Russian translation, okay? If you look in the French or the English translations of the French original or the English version of the Black Book of Communism, Yakovlev's introduction is not there. It's in the Russian edition. And so I read this edition. I read this maybe a year or two ago. I'd never read it. And in there, right about the middle of this rather long introduction, he states up front that after he heard Khrushchev's speech, he and some other like-minded people whom he did not mention, he did not name, got together secretly and decided to have a campaign to undermine communism. And their plan was to use Lenin against Stalin and Plekhanov against Lenin and Marx against Plekhanov, and ultimately to arrive to dismantle Marx. Well, they got as far as using Lenin against Stalin, and that has to do with Lenin's last writings. In all of the collections of Lenin's works, like there's a 3-volume collection, you know, a 1-volume collection published in the Soviet Union after Khrushchev's day. The documents from Lenin's last writings where he attacks Stalin are always there. In fact, all of Lenin's last writings, the ones he made from December 1922 until he finally was felled by his final stroke in March 1923. All of those documents are always published, starting with Khrushchev period. And I think that's because this plan to use Lenin to undermine Stalin. Now, I don't know how many of you were attended my talk last year, but last year, I gave a talk about the book that I had just published called The Lie of the Lenin Testament. Based upon the research of a Soviet and later Russian researcher, a history professor at Moscow University named Valentin Sakharov, I discussed the evidence that Sakharov discovered that the anti-Stalin documents that are called part of the Testament of Lenin are forgeries. Lenin never wrote them. And it's a very compelling case that has to do with all kinds of provable falsifications. So, but I'm not saying that Yakovlev knew that. Yakovlev took it for granted that Lenin really was attacking Stalin. And certainly it's legitimate to think that up until Sakharov completed his research and published it in 2003. But yes, Yakovlev, I don't know, I would say is very proud of the fact, boasts of the fact that he and some other people had a secret plan to undermine communism, and that it began with after Khrushchev's speech. Now, Yakovlev met Gorbachev sometime in the early 1980s. So there's some reason to think, although that has not been proven, there's some reason to think that Gorbachev may have known about Yakovlev's conspiracy, so to speak, to destroy communism. He certainly acted as though he was an enemy of communism and socialism. Maybe not socialism as understood in, you know, as social democracy. It seems like that's what Gorbachev had in mind, but socialism as understood by revolutionary socialism. So it could very well be that Gorbachev was consciously a part of this conspiracy that Yakovlev was boasting about around the year 2000 in that preface to the Black Book of Communism, to the Russian translation of the Black Book of Communism.
Okay, so thank you. The next person in line is Eugene Rule. Jean, please unmute yourself and ask your question.
Okay, well, thanks so much, Grover. As usual, I'm really impressed by the facts you can marshal. And I confess also that I have difficulty following all these details. And I thank you for setting the record straight on all this. Yeah. Okay. My own approach to Stalin is somewhat different, because when I think of Stalin, I think of a man who, more than any other single individual, is responsible for the defeat of Nazi imperialism and the preservation of socialist relations in the Soviet Union. So when Stalin died, every Soviet worker was guaranteed a job, guaranteed health care, guaranteed free education, and all the benefits. They also had a equal rights clause in their constitution, which we do not have here in the United States, as we all know. For me, I look at these achievements of Stalin, and I have a very positive approach. And I think that people need to understand Stalin's role in terms of preserving the human rights in the Soviet Union. And thank you for everything you've brought out in this. It's really excellent. But I'd like to have your comments, sir.
Sure. Well, briefly
on this.
If we and others, anybody goes around, talking up communism, sooner or later, usually sooner, you will get run up against the argument, well, what about the Soviet Union? What about Stalin? What about all those terrible things that happened that Stalin did? Doesn't that show that there's something rotten about the whole idea of Stalin? They're beginning to do that with Mao, of course, as well. But I think Stalin is still by far the biggest target. So it's important to understand, to spread the knowledge that the view of Stalin that that is almost universally shared is false. Okay, that these terrible crimes did not take place. That Stalin is not guilty of all of the things that we are told that he's of which he's guilty. And therefore, when you look at the history of the communist movement, if you look at the history of the Soviet Union, with the understanding that Stalin did not do all of those things, you can not only begin, well, two things. You could begin to appreciate the positive things that the Soviet Union did accomplish during his period, and even after that, as you point out. And you can also then begin to focus on, you know, what really went wrong. You can begin to seriously focus on that issue, because ultimately the Soviet Union did not build communism, right? That that trajectory got turned aside, got perverted, and ultimately got derailed altogether. That must have happened at the latest during the Stalin period, because Khrushchev came from somewhere. Okay, Khrushchev came from somewhere, and the people who were in the Central Committee when he gave the secret speech, they were veteran members of the party, and they didn't object to Khrushchev's speech. So the groundwork for the overturning or the turning aside of the trajectory of the Soviet Union towards more and more socialism, greater and greater aspects of communism under socialism. The roots of that have to stretch back at least into the Stalin period. And maybe they go back further than that. But to close briefly, I'd just like to say that Lenin didn't have a blueprint. Marx didn't have a blueprint. Nobody had a blueprint of what to do after you've conquered state power, how to build a communist society. And the Soviets made a valiant attempt. And we need to study what they did that we think was correct. And we need to try to identify and learn from those things they did that that ultimately proved incorrect. But the Soviets were pioneers. The Soviet during Stalin's time were pioneers. Pioneers always, they're the first. They don't have any kind of map or blueprint to go by. They learn by trial and error. So we have a lot to learn from them, from their successes, but also from their mistakes. But we'll never learn from their mistakes if we believe the demonized view of Stalin and the Soviet Union, that is by far the most prevalent one, that is almost universal.
Well, thank you again for the work you've been putting in on this.
Okay, so I have Kit next, but I also want to ask everybody who's there, we have 30 members right now present, that you please ask Grover a question. This is a great opportunity. If you haven't read this book and you're hesitating because you're thinking you're going to have to ask a question on this, I don't think that's necessary. The entire history of Stalin is very thoroughly studied by Professor Furr. So raise your hands, ask any question. I'm sure you will get something that you didn't know about from him. Anyway, Kit, please go ahead. You are next, and then you'll be followed by Sharon Rose.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you for coming back, Grover, and it was a pleasure to meet you and your wife a couple of weeks ago. I only have two questions I didn't get to ask you during that time. And I just want to find out from you, and these are not in your book, but maybe they are. What did you see the movie Death of Stalin, which was a popular spoof in 2017 about what happened after Stalin died and how his close circle, his committee, tried to, grab power and how Khrushchev got into place? And also the second question is, I forget where I heard about this or read about it, but I came across something that said that before Gorbachev died, he regretted promoting perestroika because of what it eventually did to the Soviet Union. Okay, that's it. Thank you.
I haven't seen the movie. I read a little bit about it. It sounds like, anti-communist nonsense to me, but since I haven't seen the movie, I can't really say that with any authority. There's never been a good study of exactly the circumstances of how Stalin died. I don't see that that's all that important. Perhaps he didn't receive medical treatment quickly enough. And as for whether there was any infighting among the leaders, there certainly was. One of the things that, and I guess this is not in the movie, I would be very surprised if it is, but you've seen the movie and I haven't. Okay, so this is an important issue. There was the Khrushchev, of course, spoke at the 20th Party Congress, which was 1956, but in 1952, in October, it was the 19th Party Congress. And the theme of the 19th Party Congress, which of course is the last Congress that Stalin was at, right, was, onwards, the next step towards communism. It's all about communism. So that's interesting. And then right after that, immediately after the Congress, there was a Central Committee plenum. That's what they call the meetings where all the Central Committee members get together. And evidently spurred by Stalin and those closest to him, the rules of the Central Committee were changed. There was to be no more Politburo, which is a relatively small body of 8 or 9 people. Instead, it was expanded to be a presidium of over 30 people. That was one of the main changes in the rules. Just one step back for a second. At the 19th Party Congress in October 52, the major work that everyone referred to was Stalin's last book, which was called Economic Problems of Socialism in the Soviet Union. That was Stalin's last book. That was supposed to be, that was referred to by everybody. It was printed in many copies and so forth and so on. No sooner did Stalin die that that book basically disappeared off the shelves, and the people who were around his deathbed simply decided to ignore the changes in the rules, the party rules that had been voted in the 19th Party Congress. They never called the large presidium again. They reverted to the membership that had been the Politburo, the much smaller group, the Politburo. There was very suspicious stuff like that was going on, started to happen right after Stalin died. And then in June 1956, now remember, March 5th, 1956, Stalin dies. He's sick for several days before that, and then he dies. In June 28th, 1956, Lavrenty Beria was either arrested, that's the official story, or as many believe, and I do too, was killed. 1953. June 28th, 1953. So less than April, May, June, a little bit more than 3 months after Stalin died. Now, when Stalin died on March 5th, 1953, the people who were around the main leaders who were around his deathbed, elected Beria to be the head of the combined Ministry of Internal Affairs, that's the MVD, and the Ministry of State Security, that's the MGB. And Beria occupied both of those positions for a little over 3 months. And then there was a decision to get rid of Beria. And as I said, either they murdered him then or they judicially murdered him later on. So that had never happened under Stalin. So it was all kinds of fishy things were taking place as soon as Stalin died. And it's even been called by some people a coup, all right? But as for the details of, you know, Stalin's actual death, it's the politics, in other words, that's the most interesting thing. And not—
Yeah, that's what seems to be in the movie. I mean, it brings up all his central committee members and mentions them. But since I'm not an expert on Stalin,
supposedly Beria said, oh, I've rescued you all, I've saved you all. This sort of supposedly means that he had somehow or other done away with Stalin. There's no evidence for any of that sort of stuff. Mm-hmm. And your second question was?
Gorbachev.
I don't know. You know, I think Gorbachev, when he was in office, of course, is of considerable interest because he launched this anti-Stalin and really anti-communist onslaught of falsifications, you know, books published in the hundreds of thousands of copies, and articles in every newspaper and every magazine about how terrible, the terrible history of the Soviet Union under Stalin. And he even started to attack, you know, Khrushchev and Brezhnev. So he's an interesting and important individual until the end of the Soviet Union. After the end of the Soviet Union, I really am just not interested in him. I don't know what he said or did not say after the end of the Soviet Union. I think I would have heard if he had come out and said perestroika was a mistake. I think that would have been publicized, but maybe not. I really don't know.
Yeah, it was published, but I can't remember where I read it or heard it.
Sure. Okay.
So that would be interesting to find. Thank you. Thank you very much, Grover.
Sure.
Okay. So next is Sharon Rose, followed by Karen Pomerantz.
Hi. Hello. Thank you for your talk, Grover. I have a comment and a question. So I once, the propaganda about how Stalin was anti-Semitic and how the Soviets were anti-Semitic and how Soviet Jewry had to be saved by transporting everyone to Israel, making them all Zionists and transporting them all to Israel, and is so overwhelming that it's hard to combat. So I once received a letter from a woman who was born in somewhere in Russia, right at the end of the Second World War. And her parents had been from Poland. And the Soviets transported a lot of Jewish people out of the way of the advancing Nazis.
Yeah.
And she wanted to know why they had done that. She asked me, well, why did the Soviets move my parents and all those other people to the East? And I was like flabbergasted to realize that her parents had never told her it was to save their lives.
Yeah.
Yeah. But my question has to do with historiography. So you have shown repeatedly how bereft and corrupt the field of Soviet history is in the West. And I'm wondering if you know about what the Chinese scholars are doing. Are there people in China who are working on the subject in terms of the overall history of the Soviet experiment, and in particular, Stalin? And have they made any contributions to the truth?
Well, I'll be very brief about that issue. I was invited to China several times because of my research on the Stalin period. I translated Khrushchev Lied into Chinese and published it. So I've talked to people who were considered, this is 8 or 9 years ago, the main scholars on the Stalin period. They were not, my research came as a big shock to them. In general, they told me straight out, and these are people in the Chinese Academy of Social Sciences. They had their, that's the most elite research institution there. I still did not have access to a great many Soviet documents. Their access to materials from outside China, even materials created in the Soviet Union, and their access to the world of the internet is very restricted. I could tell you some individual anecdotes. I'll spare you those, but I know that that's the truth. They can't get that material. And I mentioned various documents and so forth that had actually been available for quite some time. They had no idea that they were out there. I talked not too long ago, or I wrote not too long ago to a Chinese scholar of Soviet history. Of course, he knows Russian. He and I we communicate in Russian because he doesn't know any English and my Chinese is not very good. And I mentioned Yakovlev's introduction to the Black Book of Communism. He had never heard of it. And there are many other examples like that. So yes, I don't think the Chinese scholars are enabled to do the kind of research that I am doing. They don't have access to the materials. That's the way I understand it. Now, of course, I don't know any of them closely enough to ask them why they think this is. But it's clear to me they don't. They just don't have that. When I had to get some materials to one of them, I mean, I've had to get the materials myself and then cut it up into little small bits and email these small bits to them, you know, one after another, because they just can't get stuff.
Okay, so before I go to Karen, I just want to ask people, because we have still quite a bit of time on available. So if you have a question that you wanted to ask, feel free to ask. Professor Furr is very accessible, and he answers his questions if he knows. Of course, he's very evidence-based researcher, so if he doesn't know, he will tell you. But go ahead, think of what you may have thought a question, or you have a comment. Go ahead, make a comment. So Karen, you're next, and then we'll go to second round with Yusuf, unless somebody who has not spoken raises the hand in the meantime, then I'll go to that person. Karen, go ahead, please.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm a member of Progressive Labor Party, and we're trying to recruit younger people to join. And they're very resistant. I mean, they may believe in all our principles and our line and things like that, but many of them resist the idea of a party and, you know, resist the idea of revolution. And I just wonder if anybody in Grover, you have any thoughts about how we can move people. They'll join study groups, you know, and they're excellent organizers in what they do, but they really resist this idea of forming a party.
Well, maybe he'll speak and maybe he won't, but Charlie Andrews, who either is here or he was here. Oh, there he is. He's here. Charles Andrews has an excellent webpage called holocaust.com. Holocaust.com. And he has an article on that webpage that very briefly makes, I mean, I think all of his articles are really good, but he has an article that really briefly examines this question. You need to have a party, you need to have a communist party, or if you're gonna build a better society, you need to have it. And of course you need to rely on the working class. There is no more, there is no other, you know, revolutionary group. So maybe that's one approach. I certainly would recommend Charlie's articles, and particularly the one I'm referring to. I don't remember the title offhand, but you'll see it. You go to holocolossus.com, you click on it where it says articles, and he has a list of articles, and it's really very good. I don't know. I think you need to probe to see why they don't like the issue, the idea of a party. Is it because they they have been taught something negative about the history of the communist movement? Because my guess is a lot of them don't even know that, you know? But, you know, individual cases are probably different. You should probably find out in any specific case, you know, what the resistance to being in a party is all about. But certainly you should, you know, I guess you're doing it. You need to emphasize to them that without a party, you're simply not going to be able to make a revolution. There's a French philosopher. I'm sure that the people you come into contact with him or are not referring to him, but a guy named Alain Badiou, B-A-D-I-O-U, who proudly calls himself a communist promotes the idea of communism, but he thinks the concept of a party is what led to the horrible crimes of Stalin and the horrible crimes of Mao Zedong mm-hmm. and so forth. And on the basis of that and some other reasoning, he rejects the idea of a party. I think, you know, that it's doubtful that this, the young people that you are discussing these issues with, you know, have that kind of sort of sophisticated, historically based argument. But Badiou's shows that accepting the lies about Stalin and the Stalin period, for one thing, you know, leads to a dead end. Mm-hmm. If you are successfully convinced that there's something wrong with the idea of a party, that somehow or other you can build a better world without having a party, then you've been disarmed. You're just never going to do it. So I think, you know, if it's the case that they have imbibed, or I've been convinced of a false version of the history of the communist movement, particularly in the Soviet Union during the Stalin period, then of course, you know, my research may be of some help to them. In other cases, though, I think that and perhaps in all cases, and take a look at those articles in Charlie Andrews' page. Okay. I think they're really
interesting. Thank you.
Okay, and Charlie's raised his hand, so it will be after Marilyn Langlois. Marilyn, please go ahead, and then followed by Charlie, because I'm taking the people who have not spoken first. Go ahead, Marilyn.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Hello, Grover. I appreciate your presentation today. It was good to see you in person a couple of weeks ago, and along with your wife. Please give my regards to your wife.
Sure.
Anyway, my question has to do with the relationship between FDR and Stalin. Sure. Cynthia Chung and Matthew Arrett and perhaps others have written about how FDR and his vice president, Henry Wallace, intended to pursue friendly, cooperative relations between the United States and the Soviet Union after World War II. But this, of course, completely changed after FDR's death. So when the whole Cold War was initiated and an entirely adversarial relationship ensued for the next many, many years. So could you please address a little bit the relationship between FDR and Stalin?
Well, that was during the war, right? So cooperation was very important. You know, what would have happened if FDR had lived? I don't know. It's hard to believe that the contradiction between communism and capitalism, or the socialist world and the capitalist world, could have somehow become secondary to a positive relationship between FDR and Stalin, or something along those lines. It's hard to imagine that that there would not have been some kind of Cold War, necessarily because of the contradiction between capitalism and communism, between the anti-colonial struggles that were all around the world, which were, you know, that was a major feature of the post-World War II period, right? The post-World War II period from 45 to 75 is really the old colonial empires were destroyed, you know, collapsed or were beaten down. It's hard for me to believe that any president of the United States would have looked benignly on these anti-colonial struggles against the major colonial powers of the world, the Western Europe, and particularly, and just said, "Oh, sure, that's great. You know, let everybody be free." It didn't happen after the First World War. I don't see why it would have happened after the Second World War. So I don't, you know, clearly something would have been different because FDR wasn't Truman. Truman was a super anti-communist all along. He was the one who made the statements. I have it around here somewhere. And then it was quoted in the New York Times in 1941, maybe, or 1940. As saying he hopes that the 1941, obviously, he hopes that the communists and the fascists end up weakening each other as much as possible. You know, so he was I don't see that would have changed much. And of course, the Republicans would have changed. Why would the Republican Party have changed? And the civil rights movement was gonna come strongly to the fore after the war anyway. And we know that Roosevelt refused to sponsor, to promote anti-lynching law because he wanted the support of the Dixiecrat South. The solid South was democratic and it was based upon white supremacy. That wouldn't have changed. So Truman declared an end to segregation of the armed forces. How thoroughly that happened right away, I don't know. But it's hard for me to believe that things would have been much different in the long run. That's my guess.
I'm just thinking, what about if Henry Wallace had managed to be Roosevelt's vice president? Of course, he was engineered out of that role so that Henry Wallace would have been president instead of Truman after FDR's death. Sure, it would have been a struggle. It wouldn't have been easy, but, think things might have been a little different anyway with Wallace as president.
Well, I mean, if Wallace is president, no doubt. People have studied that. There are American historians who have studied the Henry Wallace, the post-World War II period, the Henry Wallace period, the Henry Wallace movement, the reasons for the Communist Party supporting his candidacy, and the degree to which the Wallace movement was controlled by, or at least largely supported by, the Communist Party. And people have studied all that, and I haven't. And so obviously some things would have been different, but would there have not been a Cold War? I think there would have had to have been a Cold War. And then what about the Republican Party? You know, the Republicans almost won in 1948, and they did win in 1952. So it's hard for me to see that the course of history would have been changed very much. But, that's just my guess.
Thank you.
Okay. Charlie is next.
Thank you for recommending the article. It's called "There Is No Socialism Without a Communist Party."
There you go. That's it.
And if it has anything to recommend it, it's not just about organizational questions. It tries to link the question to changing a mode of production. And in the chat, I put up a link to the article. That's it.
Great.
Okay.
Thanks, Charlie. So, I think all your articles are really, really useful.
Yeah. Thank you. So, so we have Alan, who has not spoken. So I'll go to Alan next.
Thank you for your presentation, Grover. There's this pattern in history. After the death of Lenin, there was upheaval in the Soviet Communist Party that led to tremendous splits and executions of former leaders. Same thing happened when Stalin died. There was a very stark reversal of policy and controversy. And I would say the same thing even happened in China after the death of Mao. Can you comment for those of us who are really committed to socialism on the historical lessons or reasons for that? This is something that has been framed by the pro-capitalist culture. You know, Animal Farm is a book that just says it's a bunch of infighting among crooks and thieves. Can you give an opinion on that?
Well, sure. China is somewhat different, but in the Soviet Union, there were, starting in the 1920s, there were opposition movements. It was a very sharp struggle over which direction should the Soviet Union go. It started even before Lenin died, because Lenin was not really, he didn't really have a blueprint either. They had the new economic policy, and so everybody supported the new economic policy, which is sort of capitalism under certain kinds of controls in the early and mid 1920s. But during this period of time, there were these ideological struggles within the Bolshevik Party, within the Communist Party of the Soviet Union, which were fought out at the party conventions during the 20s. And as we know, Stalin had his supporters, and then Zinoviev and Kamenev at first allied with him against Trotsky, and then they joined with Trotsky's oppositions. And, you know, obviously personalities had something to do with it, but in general, the struggle was over what should we do now? There are not going to be any revolutions in the advanced capitalist countries are not about to take place. What shall we do? And the whole notion of democratic centralism, the idea that everyone should support the party line, party's position as it was defined at these party conventions. Among these prominent leaders of the party, people who had been in the leadership and who were now in the opposition, they just didn't accept that. They said they accepted it, but they didn't accept it. The opposition in the early 30s, including Trotsky's, but also the right opposition, you know, Zinoviev, Kamenev, Bukharin, and all these people, sort of were convinced that collectivization was going to tear the country apart, and it was going to lead to civil war. And when that happened, the party would turn to them, realized that Stalin's ideas were wrong. And then rapid industrialization was going to do the same thing. And both of these things happened at the same time. And that the some capitalist powers, probably the Germans, were going to attack, and the Soviet Union could never withstand that. So there was a mixture of different political programs and also fear. And I'm sure self-aggrandizement, careerism had something to do with it too. But I think that for our purposes, we should think about the fact that they really didn't know where to go. And a lot of Stalin's leadership and prestige were due to the fact that he had a plan. And we know what the plan was, you know, industrialization, collectivization, ultimately democratization, which he didn't manage to get through. All to prepare for the attack by the capitalists, which he was convinced would come. But how to build communism, socialism, they don't know. Now, an interesting issue, which I have not written about, but I really need to do it, is after the war, Stalin and the Stalin leadership talked among themselves, drafted some plans about pursuing the struggle for, to get back on the road to struggle for socialism and communism. So that needs to be investigated. I'm not convinced that they would ultimately have been successful, but we really don't know what would have happened. I think it's very different in China, and I don't want to go into that now because it's just a whole different topic. But I think this is an interesting issue, and then I'll stop. Okay, so up to the late 50s, let's say, the Chinese were basically following what you might call the Stalin plan. In other words, collectivize agriculture and industrialize using your own internal resources without foreign investment. You know, the backyard, pig iron furnaces and so forth, plus the rule of the commune movement, the rule of people's commune movement. This is basically the Stalin plan, you know, adapted to China, but that's what the Soviet Union had done. And all of that stopped. There was a lot of opposition to it. It came to a head at 1959, 1960, Mao regarded it as a step backward. And ultimately the Cultural Revolution started because some party leaders, mainly in the student level, but also in other levels, started to see that traditional elitist capitalist cultural practices were coming back into vogue, were returning. And the idea of careerism within the Communist Party was a big issue. And it was an issue in both the Soviet Union and the Chinese. So I think this is a serious issue, the idea that communists, leaders can, you know, can remain leaders instead of being workers and so forth for decades and decades. And also that communist leaders have privileges, okay? That you can make a nice career for yourself as a communist leader. Your income will be higher, you have access to more consumer goods, this kind of thing, you can travel better, you have a better apartment, maybe your kids can go to better schools. All of this comes from the notion that socialism, which everybody had, the Second International had it, Marx and Engels had it, Lenin had it, that socialism is a mixture of communist elements and capitalist elements. So that nobody was demanding, well, nobody was urging for more egalitarianism in the Soviet Union early on, and even later on, even in the 40s when Stalin was still around. Egalitarianism was seen as sort of an enemy, something that was infantile leftist, something that was, you know, not appropriate yet. And Lenin had attacked egalitarianism, Marx had attacked egalitarianism, the critique of the Goethe program. So the preservation of inequalities and privileges, I think, was a serious factor in the cultivation and promotion of capitalist ideas in these two parties. And I don't really want to say any more right now.
Okay. Actually, I wanted to ask a question, and since no other hands are up in the first round, I wanted to ask you, reading Molotov Remembers, the book, which is an interview over 17 years of Molotov before he died, but after he was pushed out of the party, and then eventually he was given place in the party. One question was asked by the author, the person who was interviewing him, Chuyev is his name, I think there's a poet. And he asked him, what were your differences, if there were any significant differences with Stalin on ideology. And he said, Stalin believed, and he agreed with him that you have to build socialism where you have captured power, even if it might be the only country at that moment. You have to attempt to build socialism.
Sure.
Then sooner or later, you will have other countries who will form enough of a bloc to maintain economic. Because alone, you cannot do anything. Even capitalism cannot do alone, you know. So it's a global system. But then Stalin later on also believed that Soviet Union can move into communism. And at this point, of course, the first condition was fulfilled, because when China had a revolution, there was another country, major country. So for socialism to survive, there were conditions created. But Molotov said he disagreed with Stalin whether Soviet Union can move towards communism. What have you come across about this in the literature that you've studied, and how do you see it?
Well, I don't know. I think that Stalin wrote several times that the final victory of socialism in the Soviet Union has to await revolutions in other countries. So that's interesting. He made that statement a number of times, and it kind of gives the lie to Trotsky's state. Trotsky claimed, and Trotsky has continued to claim, that if you believe in socialism, building socialism in one country, then somehow or other you're abandoning the demand for world revolution. But those two things are not in contradiction to each other. I don't know. After World War II, there were the Politburo drafted some documents about the next stage in moving towards communism. But it was another stage. It wasn't communism. And there was some discussion of that. Those documents were only published within the last couple of years. And then there was some discussion of that at the 19th Party Congress, but the proceedings of the 19th Party Congress were never published. Okay, of all of the Congresses, the Communist Party of the Soviet Union is the only one whose transcript was never published. And I don't know exactly how Stalin ultimately conceived of the movement from socialism to communism. But it seems to me that by the end of World War II, the Soviet Communist Party, the leadership of the Soviet Communist Party was concentrated on production of material goods and not the ideologically committed to the goal of communism. In fact, at the Central Committee plenum, this very, very long Central Committee plenum of June to July 1937, right? Yeah. The minutes of which were only published after the end of the Soviet Union. Stalin ended up his speech, and this was published at the time. He ended up his final speech. He spoke twice. He ended up his final speech by saying that they had set up party schools. He said that understanding of Marxism-Leninism is very weak in the party. And they're going to set up party schools, and that every party leader from the heads of the parties in the different republics to down to, you know, leaders of party cells in villages were going to eventually circulate through party schools to study Marxism-Leninism. And the higher up you were, the longer the schools were going to be. And he instructed all of the party leaders to pick two associates who would replace them while they were off at Moscow, presumably, studying Marxism-Leninism at these schools. And this speech of Stalin's was, well, at least that part of the speech of Stalin's was in fact published at March 1937, after the end of the Central Committee plenum. And that never happened. That never happened, okay? Those schools never took place. The party leaders never went to them. Clearly there must have been a lot of resistance. Now, as far as we know, nobody voted against this proposal at the plenum, but the fact that it never happened means something. Means, I think, that there was opposition to it. So the commitment to production, very understandable in the 1930s, collectivization of agriculture and industrialization to be able to become an advanced country, to be able to beat back the attacks of whatever advanced capitalist country was going to attack the Soviet Union. Probably Germany and Japan, but who knew, with such emphasis on production that the idea of building communism fell into second or third place. Otherwise, the future history of the Communist Party of the Soviet Union is very hard to explain. Somehow or other, the idea of communism got lost in the shuffle, at least among the party leaders. There are stories about Khrushchev after calling up other people, other party leaders, after Stalin died, saying, you know, what do we do now? And one of them said, well, you should read Bolshevik, you know, which by that time had been renamed Communist, which is the theoretical journal of the parties. Khrushchev said, I've never read that journal. I can't understand that stuff. I can't make head or tail of it. I think that's probably a lot of truth in that.
Okay, so thank you. I have two more hands raised, and we have about 6 minutes. So Yusuf is first, followed by Jean.
Thank you. Just as a point of information about something that came up, I'm Turkish. I was at Middle East Technical University, Ankara, when Gorbachev and Reza visited. I was a faculty member, so I was able to attend his presentation. He said that he had embarked on a new experiment, he lamented that it was cut short, it didn't go basically the way that he wanted, and that he favored something like the Soviet Union to solve the conflicts that were going on. And sure. This was shortly after the fall of the Soviet Union in the first half of the 1990s. That's what I know. I also know that the pro-Soviet Turkish parties were called to, I read about this, I don't know firsthand, were called to Moscow during Gorbachev, and they were instructed, even if they were underground, to join social democratic parties and give up the struggle against capitalism. Those are I know.
Yeah, that's associated with, that kind of policy is associated strongly with Khrushchev, although you can sort of see elements of that even in the late Stalin period. Anyway, thank you.
Okay, Gene.
Thank you. I just want to make a couple real quick points. One, earlier I stressed the fact that, the material benefits that were provided by socialism with Stalin. And I wanted to mention an interesting little book, Why Women Have Better Sex, under socialism.
Yes, yes.
Yes.
By Kristen Godsey.
Yeah, you know the book.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a nice little book. Yeah. Always worth reading.
Yeah.
The other thing I wanted to say is about the, you know, there was some speculation about had FDR lived and what would have happened after World War II. And I want to stress that, you know, first of all, we have to remember that the atomic bomb happened, which was developed under the leadership while FDR was president. Yeah. And it was dropped on Hiroshima. And that was the beginning of the Cold War, many of us believe. That within months of Hiroshima, the United States was threatening to bomb Moscow, which was our former ally. So I just wanted to bring that out. I think it's an important point about contemporary geopolitics.
There's something that
the United States still has a first use policy in terms of nuclear weapons, the Biden administration.
There's a plan, you can look it up in Wikipedia. There was a plan after World War II, which is associated with Churchill, called Operation Unthinkable. Churchill and some other British leaders apparently got together and decided it would be a good idea if they could do it to get all the Allied troops together to rearm the Germans and everybody invade the Soviet Union in 1945, after VE Day. And it wasn't put into practice and so forth. But there was a real plan, and then you can read about it various places. And I would start with the Wikipedia page.
Yeah.
There was tremendous class consciousness. The capitalists are very class conscious.
They're
usually more class conscious than the working class and even the communist movement.
Mm-hmm.
The capitalists are very class conscious. They're not about to. They're very suspicious about making alliances with people who don't like capitalism. I think that some version of the Cold War was inevitable.
Right. The other thing is that they didn't have any bombs left after they, you know, it takes a
while to build. Yeah, bombs. That's right.
They didn't have any, or maybe they would have. Anyway.
The atomic spies were so important, because it was important that the Soviets knew that. Mm-hmm. They didn't have any other bombs.
Okay, so there's one more question I want to give this person. Rich Johnson, who's a committee member as well, a planning committee member. Rich, please go ahead.
Thanks, Raj. I know we're at the end here. So I want to just make a comment, both to Grover, and I will say not only to Raj, who's moderating today, but all of the questions. And I just want to acknowledge or reference how rich this conversation has been. And I have something to say about Stalin in a sentence. And that is, when people go after Stalin, for whatever reason, I just say, I personally do not believe in the great man theory of history.
Right.
History is made by lots of people. We could say by the masses, but definitely Stalin was not acting by himself, by anything and everything that anyone has ever accused him of. It took many people, even if it's two or three, to make any kind of order, whether it came from a collective. If people think he made all these decisions that they accuse him of individually, that's some total BS. And anybody think for 2 seconds can figure it out. So anyway, I want to go back to my first point. Thank you very much for being so accessible, so available. And thank you to all the people that asked questions, made comments. This was a rich discussion, and I really loved it. So thank you very much.
I would like to just make one last remark. Our new book, Stalin Exonerated, which I spoke about today, is normally priced at $25 on Amazon. But for the next month or so, we're having a special sale. You can get it from me or from my publisher for $20, and we'll pay the postage. So I'm sure that all of you know my email address. If you're interested, you could send me an email, and I'll send you my mailing address, or I'll send you the link to my publisher's address. And if you're interested in buying a copy, that would be fine. And you basically save $10, because the shipping and handling is almost virtually $5 by the time you buy the envelope. And then $5 off the price. So you get the book for $20 post name. Okay. So don't.
Jim Hilliard has asked, is it available in France? Because he lives in France.
It's being translated. Oh, it's
being. No, in English. He reads English, but he's living in France.
Oh, sure. It's on, go to Amazon.fr and it's listed there.
Okay.
Amazon.France. And all my books are in English are listed there and you can get them in France. You don't have to pay shipping from the United States. You can get them there.
Well, thank you very much, Grover. Okay.
Thank you very much for attending my talk. Yes.
I want to suggest that you might look into this transition era, how Khrushchev and his policies came to replace Stalin and his policies. That would be a good research subject for you if you had time.
Very good.
Because we want to know that transition. We're mystified by why a longtime party member like Khrushchev would do what he did. Yeah.
We also want to know what the Soviets did that was right and what they did that was wrong. What they did that screwed up. I don't think we should have the idea in the back of our minds that if only Stalin had lived to be 140 years old or something like that, there would be communism in the Soviet Union.
We have to check China's progress in that direction. Yes. Xi has a very strong control of those ideas and is moving it along according to their local thinking on the subject and moving it past toward where they want to go. And also Cuba, Venezuela, they've all tried and succeeded here and there, subject to the U.S. bombardment against their efforts. Hi, Grover.
Hi, Norma. Thanks for coming.
Institute for the Critical Study of Society at the Niebuhr-Proctor Marxist Library receives no corporate funding, nor do we have any paid staff. We rely on the support of working class folks that share our commitment to the socialist legacy of Karl Marx. We continue to need funds to meet necessary expenses. Since we can no longer pass the hat at our in-person forums, please send contributions to our treasurer, either online via PayPal or by check. The PayPal ID is ICSSSunday, SUNDAY, at yahoo.com. And the name is Richard Fallenbaum. And checks may be made out to Richard Fallenbaum and sent to him at 1225 Nielsen Street, Berkeley, California, 94706. Fallenbaum is spelled Fallenbaum. To donate directly to the Marxist Library, send a check to the Niebuhr-Proctor Marxist Library at 6501 Telegraph Avenue, Oakland, California, 94609. Or donate online at www.paypal.me/npml. For information, write to npml at marxistlibr.org. And the website is marxistlibr.org.